Hi, I'm Yannis Karalambos, and this video is part of an undergraduate logic class given at Telecom Bretagne in Brest, Brittany, France. In the movie Monty Python and the Holy Grail, there is a very famous sequence where it is logically proven that a charming young lady, actually Connie Booth, who at the time was the wife of John Cleese, is a witch. We will show, by using first-order logic resolution, that the Monty Python reasoning is fallacious. If you don't know what first-order logic resolution is, I advise you to read chapter 10 of the excellent book by Mordechai Ben-Ari, Mathematical Logic for Computer Science, published by Springer in 2012. But now let us see the sequence.
There are ways of telling whether she is a witch.
Are there? Huh? Well, they tell us.
Tell me, what do you do with witches? And what do you burn apart from witches?
More witches! Wood!
So, why do witches burn?
Because they're made of wood.
Good! So, how do we tell whether she is made of wood?
Build a bridge out of her!
Ah, but can you not also make bridges out of stone?
Oh, yeah.
Does a wood sink in water?
No, it floats! It floats! Throw her into the pond!
What also floats in water?
Bread! Apples!
Very small rocks!
Cider! A great gravy! Cherries!
Mud!
Churches!
Lead!
A duck!
Exactly! So, logically,
she weighs the same as a duck. She's made of wood.
And therefore...
A witch! A witch!
Very good. We shall use my larger scales.
Now that we have seen the sequence, let us formalize the various arguments used. First of all, what do we do with witches? We burn them. This can be formalized as for all x, if x is a witch, then b of x, we burn x. Second argument, what else do we burn? Wood. Same kind of formula. X wood implies X is burnt. What does wood? It floats. Third formula. If X is wood, this implies F of X. So F means that it floats. What else floats? A duck. So I will use a constant for the duck. So this formula is simply F of D. So ducks float. Now, there is an argument which is implicit in the Monty Python reasoning, which is that everything having the same weight as an object that floats, floats as well. So how do we formalize this? For all x and y, f of x, so x is floating, and W, which means weight, so W of X equals W of Y. So this conjunction implies that we have F of Y, so Y is floating. Now, at the end of the sequence, you saw that it was experimentally proven that the young lady has the same weight as a duck. This can be written as y of young lady, w of y of young lady equals w of d. So obviously we don't care about the scientific accuracy of that measurement. What we care about is the logic. Now, the conclusion we wish to have is that she is a witch. So, formula alpha, witch of young lady. So, we have the situation where our knowledge base is made of six formulas from 1 to 5 and E. And we want to prove that the additional statement, which YL, is a consequence of our knowledge base. To do this using the method of resolution, we will first write all formulas in conjunctive normal form, like this. And we will take the negation of the conclusion we wish to have. The method of resolution consists in showing that the conjunction of all formulas in my knowledge base and the negation of the conclusion I wish to obtain is unsatisfiable. Now, in our case, we will show that this conjunction is in fact satisfiable. So there is an interpretation in which we can have both all formulas of the knowledge base being true and the negation of the conclusion we want. And this negation means that she is not a witch. So this conjunction is true. Now, when performing resolution, we calculate resolvents. And what we want to obtain is the empty set. Now, if we look at the formulas, we will see that in formulas 1 and 2, we have a term B of X, which does not appear elsewhere in the knowledge base. This means that we cannot get rid of this term, and so these two formulas are useless for our resolution. The same argument can be applied to formulas 3 and to the negation of alpha, because in the case of 3, we have the term negation of WO, and in the case of the negation of the argument, we have the term negation of WI, which again are isolated and cannot possibly be eliminated by any other formula. So we remain with three formulas, 4, 5, and E. Now, the only two resolvents we can calculate are made of 4 and 5, in which case we obtain this resolvent, where we have eliminated f of d and the negation of f of x, where previously we have substituted x by d, so we get resolvent 1. And we can also obtain a resolvent by combining formula E and formula 5. In this case, in formula 5, we will substitute x by yl and y by d. And so we obtain resolvent 2. Now we can make a last attempt of obtain an empty set by combining resolvent 1 and 2, and we get resolvent 3. So, as you can see, these are all possible calculations we can do to obtain new resolvents. None of them is the empty set. So, this formula is satisfiable, and this means that the fact that the young lady is a witch is not a consequence of our knowledge base. So now this has been at last formally proven. There has been a very interesting attempt by Jesse Hui, who is professor at Waterloo University in Canada, to show that if we expand first order logic, then the Monty Python reasoning is correct after all. So Jesse Hui makes the following suggestion. Together with the traditional inference rule of modus ponens, which exists ever since Aristoteles, he introduces a new inference rule, which he calls modus bogus. The modus bogus is somehow the opposite of the modus ponens, and says that if we have alpha implies beta and beta, then we can infer that we have alpha. Now, how does he use the modus bogus to show that the reasoning is correct and that the young lady, however charming, is a witch after all? He first proves a theorem which states that everything made out of wood is a witch. To prove this, he takes first the modus ponens of formula 2, which says that wood burns, and then he uses modus bogus to the formula 1, which says that witches burn, to obtain that wood is witch. After this, he proves proposition 1, which states that the young lady floats. For this, there is no need to use modus bogus. Modus ponens is sufficient. So he takes, first of all, formula 4, which states that ducks float. And then he takes the experimental result, where it has been shown that the young lady has the same weight as a duck. So if we combine those two and use modus ponens with formula 5, which states that everything having the same weight as something that floats, floats as well, we obtain that the young lady floats. Second proposition, where he states that the young lady is made of wood. To prove this, he takes the first proposition, the young lady floats, and formula number 3, and he uses modus bogus. And by this he obtains that the young lady is made of wood, since wood floats. Finally, he combines proposition 2, young ladies of wood, and the theorem saying that everything that is made of wood is a witch, and by a very traditional modus ponens, we can conclude that the young lady is a witch after all. Thank you.